Shabbat or even during the week. This would be like also the meditation for the week, you understand, or for the other six or so days coming forward. You know what I'm saying? I mean, am I making myself clear or making it absolutely clear? And there's a difference. So what I have here is a summary, and I'm trying to look at the Wikipedia if I could find out what's the difference between the two. You know what I'm saying? Like you go to one page, you know they have like the disambiguation page. When you look up something, they say, do you mean such and such? Do you mean this or that? Like things that have similar names to it. You know what I mean? Like if you say look up Israel, or you might get also black or Hebrew. They might have black Hebrew, so they'll give you like a disambiguation page. If you click on that, then you actually go to another like subset of the particular subject matter, of the particular issue. So I had wanted us to really study from the overview. Now, as far as which reading for this week or this Shabbat, this Senbet, it would actually be the 50th portion, but then I was studying it, and perhaps with one Shabbat, you know, like if you look at the reading for the 51st, which is Nitzavim in the Hebrew, or Komat Chuchal, which means, right. and you all stand, is really the one that we read right before Yom Kippur, right before Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah, how many of y'all saw the video where I tried to explain the Melkam Adis Ledet and the solar and the lunar, the Christian and the Jewish, or the Judeo and the Christian aspect, the mother and the father aspect?
I tried to study those videos in detail. I think I was watching that one about the where you broke down the years, but it was, I think it was right around that one is right around the leprosy one you did. So I kind of had mixed them up when I was writing it in my folder, but I do remember the one where you were on the solar and the lunar, the calculations in time with the leap year and how they thought it was a leap year here in the
right.
U.S., but it's really not.
Because last Ethiopian Addis Ahmed was actually the 12th, if you recall. It was the 12th of September. And it's interesting in a sense because when the revolution and all that also occurred, it also occurred, I think, on a leap year too in Ethiopia.
Wow.
You know, which is a whole other matter right there. But yeah, in other words, our leap year in a sense already occurred, and they are having, you know, like right now, this is a new year we're already in a new year in Christ, right?
Yeah.
In the new covenant, having father, mother, brother, and sister, you know what I mean? And now we're about to honor the Judaic aspect, which is the so-called Rosh Hashanah. You know what I'm saying? Because these both belong to us. But how do they
right.
fit?
Right, the Hebrew and the Amharic, right? The Hebrew and the Ethiopic.
I didn't hear the I clear. You
my
there?
Apologies. The Hebrew and the Ethiopic?
In other words,
yeah, that's how I've been trying to study it too.
Yeah, and how many of y'all saw the video? I think this is really this was almost like a revelation to me while I was recording it, and even before I recorded it. And it's interesting that that's when the hit came against the Ethiopian world net. I noticed whenever some new growth happens, at least in my life, or a new understanding or perception, I used to think that, like, when I was growing up, I would get a little sick, right? You know, like you get a cold or something like that. But it's always at some time when it's almost like you're growing. So it's almost like the Lord slows you down for a moment. Like you may think, even as people persecuting you or things are going on, but the Lord wants you just to be quiet for a moment, or he's trying to show you something. So it's like when this new revelation on a certain level came through for I and I. This was at the very same time as we got the strike against the Ethiopian World Net or the Ilnet account. And so we wasn't able to post that video. We was really excited to post the 49th Torah portion, Kia Te'ah. Or in Amharic, Be'wetahim Gizeh. Be'wetah, when you male, enter or come out, Gizeh, when y'all come out, like go out to the battlefield, in other words, to come out, or like to enter in a sense, what Ahim Gizeh. And what the Most High revealed, what Abba revealed, was the Torah portion. And this I would like to kind of go through for a moment with the item, because I think it's very important. And once ones get this, it would really help to inspire their own study and growth even more. And even when you're seeing like the Old Testament things, you begin to see it in Christ and through Christ, Yeshua. You know what I mean? You begin to see exactly what he meant when he said that y'all search the scriptures thinking that you have eternal life or ever-living life, right? But these are they which testify of me. In other words, some find it to be a hard thing to think that, well, the Old Testament, somebody just came in, that the Old Testament, that the Old Testament is actually testifying of Christ, of the Son, and that His Majesty, Abba, is basically verifying or bearing witness, as Christ said, that nobody bears witness to me but the Father. Now, that doesn't mean that we're not to be His witnesses, but the one who gives an exact and a perfect witness to the Son is the Father. And that's what Christ was actually, when He's talking about the Son of Man coming, and then he puts in that the Father loves you, the Father. And in that day you will ask me nothing because the Father loves you. And if you ask in my name anything to the Father, He will give it to you. And so we have the many people asking His Majesty, are you Christ? Are you Christ? And I begin to think about, you remember in the gospel when I think Peter got that revelation by the Holy Spirit that Yeshua was the Son of God and that He was the Moshiach, He was the Messiah, He was Christos, He was the Son of God. And you recall how Yeshua said, don't tell nobody. Don't tell nobody these things until He's glorified, until He's resurrected. And I began to think and say, wait, that would perfectly explain why His Majesty basically was so silent or reticent on it. Because he would not say, well, I am not anointed to say I am not, because as the King of Kings of Ethiopia, Yehovah saying, of course we know that He was anointed by the same priesthood that has descendancy from the Levitical priesthood, Solomon and the Queen of Sheba and the renewing of the kingdom in David. Yehovah's, well, why they even said in a couple of the interviews when somebody would ask His Majesty about being Christ, that His Majesty would not answer. Even in that interview, His Majesty doesn't answer. He says about how he's, you know, heard of this idea. He's even spoken to certain Rastafarians, and he made it very clear that I'm a man, I'm immortal, I will be replaced by the oncoming generation, and that they should never make a mistake in pretending or assuming that man is emanated from a deity. And, you know, I committed this to memory because, you know, a lot of folks won't be like, he said, I said, where in there does he say Jesus? Where in there does he say Christ? Where in there does he say I am or I am not? Because if he said I am Christ, Yovas, then remember what the word of the Son was. You know what I'm saying? With the word of the Son, that many will come. You understand, saying that He is Christ and there is Christ and shall deceive many. Yehovah, then when we look in His Majesty's generation, before His Majesty, 1892, 1930, and even around that time, there were a lot of other kind of, you know, that's where the New Ageism among Europeans and other folks basically started to kind of sprout out even before that particular time. And when you study carefully this emanation philosophy thing, you'll find out that it traced directly to the secret doctrine by Helena Blavatsky and then her disciple. Yes, they are females, they're disciples, and she had a disciple, and her disciple was named Alice Bailey. And now if you go and check out on the YouTube, you might have already checked it out, you could check out Externalization of the Hierarchy. That's the whole agenda that's going on right now. In other words, what we're seeing is an outward manifestation of the satanic hierarchy. In other words, while the satanic hierarchy was a cult and was like, in a sense, off-world, they are now, because they said, is God dead? You know, they say, Rasta, your God is dead. It seems to them. You know what I mean? You remember, he's the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. That means that, really, he is the overcomer. But there would be a time where it would seem, like it seems now, that all is lost. You know what I'm saying? That all is lost. You know, the father, greetings. Greetings, whoever came forward. That the Father and the Son, they do have a sense of humor. I remember Psalm 2. It says that he laughs in heaven as he sees, you know, he has them in derision. You know what I'm saying? He laughs because he sees that their day is coming. And if we're able to receive it, we recognize we're living in some crazy times like that even right now, not to even talk about what's going on in the other part of the world surrounding Ethiopia. There's nothing but enemies and wars and rumors of wars, mm-hmm. with like Jerusalem is being besieged, you understand, from all sides. Okay, that's it, all that. Thank you for listening, brothers and sisters. That's it, all that. But I want to get to the main point, because you know we can reason on that, and that's interesting, but I think this is even more interesting, because if one get this right here, it's from Hebrews chapter 10, right? Hebrews chapter 10. Now, you remember the Torah, this is what we're studying right here. This is what, from a kind of a Old Testament perspective, but I want us to get stuck in Old Testament, because then we'll lose all the blessings of God in Christ, of Abba in Jesus Christos in the New Covenant. But it's important, you understand, because the law is good, the law is holy, but nobody could fulfill it apart from the blameless example of Jesus Christos. That's the word of our Father. That's the word of Abba. So while we are looking at the Old Testament, it's important to receive the Holy Spirit so that as we're studying these things in the Old Testament, we can really see Christ, see Yeshua, see the Abba working through what he fulfills in the New Covenant. So right here where it says in Hebrews chapter 10 from verse 19, I discussed this with a couple of the brothers and sisters I've spoken with, you know, on one-on-one or a couple of us on the line, because I was just sharing this with everyone, and I want to share this with the eye of them, because remember, the law came through Moses, right, but grace and truth comes through our Adonai, our Geta, our Lord, and Medhane, right, our Savior, Jesus Christus, Yeshua HaMoshiach. Remember when it says that when they read the Old Testament, there's a veil over their eyes in the reading of the Old Testament. Anyone who is not familiar with that word?
Say that again. I'm sorry.
I know what veil means. I definitely know what the veil means. They're in the darkness. They cannot see.
Well, anyway, hold on for hold on for a moment, because since there's many of us who are meeting in the ear, you know, we're meeting in the ear. Maybe this is the rapture. You know what I mean? Even though we're here or there, we still. I mean, overstand. You know, a lot of what we've gotten is misinterpretation. Not saying that there is not a rapture. But a lot of what we've gotten is based on a Gentile, Eurocentric interpretation that thought that the black man at best is, and black woman and child is three-fifths of what they are, but then they tell the science is recessive. They have recessive. You know what I mean? This is not to even poke fun, but this is the truth. You know what I'm saying? This is the truth that we have to really recognize that we have been sold. For example, there was another posting. We didn't even get around to posting it up because of all this that we've been going through over the last week or so, right? But in this other posting, we really got to recognize that that whole idea, they're telling us that the Antichrist is coming. You know, like they tell us that Bush is the Antichrist. Okay, Bush is out of office. Okay, well, Obama is the Antichrist. Okay, they were saying Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan was the Antichrist. You know what I mean? So they're always saying this one's the Antichrist, that one's the Antichrist. It's like they're always trying to push a divine prophecy or revelation or cause the day of the Lord or cause the end of the world. Or it's like when the Lord says, when Yahweh says, he says, to, why are you rushing? I'm paraphrasing now, but why are you rushing the day of the Lord? The day of the Lord is not light. It's a dark day. You understand? I mean, it's some really bad things. There's some really bad people out there. And beyond the people, there's some really bad entities out there. And if we're naked, you see, if we don't have Yeshua HaMashiach on, and especially I and I as Rastafari, we do not have any excuse. We don't. Because we can't say, well, Selassie, yeah, you can say that. But then if somebody says, you mean His Imperial Majesty, my father? Well, check it out. What does His Majesty say? You know what I'm saying? So, and it's not there so much to just checkmate someone, but it's there to say, listen, it's very clear. Like when Christ says that no one can get to the Father except through me, and then if we say, well, Haile Selassie is the Father, and we go check the Father, what does the Father say? The Father say that Jesus Christos is the way, right? And so the Father now is fulfilling His part of prophecy, and He is testifying of His salvation. You understand? Where it says He shall visit all nations, He shall testify His salvation in word and deed. But it's I and I the Rastafari and I and I elders in Rastafari that really got that spiritual revelation that when we saw Him, like what Peter did. Remember Peter? Peter said, he said, well, who do men say I am? Well, they say you're a prophet. They say that you like Jeremiah. Some say you are John the Baptist coming in, right? And then Yeshua said, well, who do you say I am? And then it was a Petros, it was Peter. You understand? It was Peter who said what? Peter said, he said, you are the Christ, the Son of God, or the Son of the living God. Wow. And what did Yeshua say? What did Jesus say? He said that flesh and blood could not have told you this. In other words, he received like a rhema, instant revelation. This is what happened to I and I's Rastafari and the Rastafari movement. That when we saw His Majesty, right, we saw the spirit of Jesus Christ. We said, this is Yeshua. This is Jesus. This is the Father and the Son of they have one nature. You understand? I mean, there's a human aspect and there's the divine aspect. And this is, I don't know if anyone saw the recent Rastafari remembers Abuna
Yisrael.
See, that we posted, and not even to get all theological. It's not to get all like theologians arguing about words and terminologies. No, if we're going to walk this out, we got to know what the instructions really say. Otherwise, we're going to be in the outer court of religion, where we're learning it, where we're disciplined and reading it and studying it, but we're not able to live it in spirit. You know what I'm saying? In other words, we're not. For example, When they shut down the account, you know, they didn't shut it down completely yet. We know that the Holy Spirit, what says that the Father doesn't do anything or allow anything to happen unless He first shows His servants the prophet. So I kind of already knew that this was coming at this channel. When I thought, I said, what? We have over like 1,500 videos on one channel. How do we get there? No, for real. Honestly, I'm like 1,500. I'm like, and then I thought, I said, well, I know we have a lot of it in backup. You know, like, you know, when we record and put up, we try to back them up. But we don't have, like, a snapshot of what we have there in case we need to reduplicate it somewhere else on our own site, so forth and so on. So this crisis, I and I have seen it as an opportunity. And to this very minute, I have resisted the evil temptation to stress out or to get depressed. And it's only because I keep thinking about that word in Matthew 5, I think it's 18 to 20. He says, when they shall say all manners of evil against you for my name's sake, with a rejoice and be exceeding glad, right? The only thing I'm concerned about is, like, I hope everyone who can download and back up backs up while you can, because this is, you know, it's out there. Don't think that these other entities, these opposition, these antichrists to Christ and his kingly character, they don't have copies of it. They probably have copies of everything. And I've been surprised how many vids that we use Bob Marley's music on, and you can't see it. You can't see it. You understand? I mean, we actually wrote it down when we was downloading some, going over a double check who the cap fits by Burhana Selassie. Got about 4,000 views blocked by YouTube because UMG, Universal Music Group. No. Universal Catholicos, Kahulum Belai. No, Catholic Music Group has blocked it. Right? Man Child Revelation. Part 13, Revelation 13, got about a little over 2,500 views. Can't see it no more. Mystical Exile of Haile Selassie in Bath, England, got almost 8,500 views. Can't see it anymore. Revelation 12, Jehovah Witness and right. Mystical right. Exile in Bath. Wait, what'd you say?
But I wanted to ask you, did they do that all at the same time?
No, they did it while men slept. You remember our master, you remember Adonai's parable? He said while men slept, then came the evil one.
Right.
You know, and it was while we were doing right. other stuff, you know, whether it was really important stuff or it was just personal stuff, while nobody saw what was going on. Because really, if somebody saw what was going on, they should blow the trumpet. Yo, one of our videos got. Because it's not ionized videos. Wait, well, all this is ionized? No, this is our thing. Each of us have a calling. You know what I'm saying? And it's for each of us to recognize that calling. And all I'm doing, like Christ said, I'm just a miserable servant doing what. Not just I have to do, but it's like what I love to do. You know what I'm saying? So when they revile us and say, wait, they said the video, the reason why they gave us the strike was because of a video that some of y'all might have seen, that the black man's problem, the black man, and we identified as the lost sheep of the Beit Israel, the house of Israel, right? The black man, Israel, right? His problem is a God problem, and that was a Willie Lynch Revisited vid. And they said that, you know, hate speech, you know, we want everybody to be able to say what they got to say, but, you know, we don't tolerate no hate against no group. No, I said, what hate? And you know what it was? We've got to see a video. Someone else, I think it was All the Names, whichever brother or sisters or ones, All the Names. That's the All the Names site had that video up there. You understand? It was the same video that was blocked or not. So it wasn't like they are universally blocking it, but they want to find reason or occasion, right? They want to find a reason or occasion, basically, so they can say, well, you know what? We can't allow you to broadcast anymore. Because, you know, this is not our first rodeo. You know, I mean, in other words, Ethiopian World, if any of you recall Ethiopian World, that was like, I guess, our first beta test. You know what I mean? And that site had a couple of hundred videos there, Yovas, and this is when we came forward with Ethiopian World Net, Yovas, and we're not even fretting that, frustrating that, because, you know, how many of y'all seen the seventh mystery, the Dragnet?
I think I listened to it.
All right.
But I was remembering something he was talking about, the Dragnet.
Yeah, because that's another one of Christ's parables. So remember how we started out with the sower? And little would I know that actually just in walking the walk and talking the talk that actually Christ's other parables would fulfill. And this is like the Rhema word, where you start to see certain things in his word. You see how it really applies in your life. You can see it's almost like he was talking directly only about your experience, even though you know it's speaking to all of the brothers and the sisters in faith, wherever they are, in whatever situation that they are going through. So
It's for our eyes.
You know, it's for our eyes to recognize that. That's why this verse 10:20 in Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 20, where it says, by a new and a living way, which he has consecrated, that means made it holy. Remember, Kedus, Kedase, Yetek, Edese, says to remember, think about the Sabbath, to keep it yetekedeset, to keep it kedus, to keep it set apart. You know what I'm saying? Set apart from every other day. And what's every other day for? Every other day is for I and I, you know, whether we're in school, whether we're in work, to do our personal, private, occupational labor, you know, how we feed our face, take care of our youth or whatever else. But the Sabbath day is supposed to be a day set apart from that, because that's the time that we get our spiritual energies, our groundation, our foundation, so that we can wage holy warfare, you understand, the rest of the week. And I'm going to prove it to the eye, because there's a psalm that the Jews, I had actually called them OJs, and if you look at the latest video
you see what someone was like,
I'm so offended that you call us the OJs. Some of us really were killed by the fascists. I'm like, what are we saying about the it's agent provocateurs. You know what I mean? It's basically to put things out there and say, oh, you're about hate speech, because they hate the speech of truth. The Second Thessalonians will tell you that right there. You understand? Because they say that Christ, our Lord and Savior, our black Lord and Savior, will destroy, right, Antichrist by the breath of his mouth. And it's not just the breath of his mouth, but it's, well, you know what the word says? As he is, so are we in the world. You see, but we have to get our faith up to that. In other words, we have to accept that as being true. You see what I'm saying? And that's where the real work, you know, it says the work is to believe, King James Version, to believe or to amen, to mamen, to trust, to admit. That's the real work. Because, you know, some of the things that we may read in the scripture, you know, of course we'll love it all in truth and the goodness that happened to us, but some of it does seem, and this will, you have to remember grace and truth. You have to be honest. And let me testify first. Some of this stuff I read in the Bible sounds very good, but it almost sounds like impossible. It sounds like, wow. So that's where I had to begin in my walk. You know what I mean? That's where I had to begin in my walk right there with that. You understand? To recognize, Father, in the name of Jesus, you know, I want to do this. I accept it, but... you know, I think this is a little bit difficult right here. You understand? So he shows me the verse where it says, "Nothing is impossible for Abba." Yeah, I don't know why I got a feedback right here. Huh?
Someone has speaker on. I think we had that earlier. Maybe there's someone speaker or.
Yeah, they
got to
take that off.
Yes, sir. I clear it up.
Yeah. Okay, give thanks. Give thanks, my brother. So check this out right here, and I want all of the eye to really groundate on this. Even if we don't get to go through every particular point and detail, I mean, the word when you're approaching spiritual is so high, it's so it has depth, it has breadth. It's like going through the same sabbatical portion like a year later. I'm like, why didn't I see that before? You know what I mean? Like, it's like, why didn't I get that? You know what I mean? So it's like there is not like like people say, oh, I read that. Yeah, you read it, but do you really hear it? Did you hear it? Did you read it? Did you study it? Did you memorize it? Then you can meditate on it. Really, if we don't first of all square the foundation, our meditation is just basically, you know, a little puff, listen to reggae music. You know, we're just chilling. There's nothing wrong with that, but let's not call it meditation, you understand, unless we really know what meditation, you know what I'm saying, unless we know what meditation really is. Because remember, we are saved by grace. The law came by Moses, but the law, remember, is the ministration of death. See, the law was given to preserve Israel, you understand, and preserve the seed, you understand, till the Moshiach came, until Messiah came, because the devil was trying to destroy the God seed, trying to destroy the black seed. He was trying to destroy that particular seed that he needed to replace what Adam had done. Because Adam was, remember, the first Adam. You understand? Now Yeshua HaMoshiach is called the second Adam. You understand? Or the second template. So it had to be of that same seed, not just for racial reason, oh, because it's black. No. Because remember, you have to correct the first. If the first is messed up, you have to correct the first. You can't correct the second or the third that came from the first. You have to correct the first. You know what I'm saying? That's why when we call Yeshua HaMashiach, he is the second Adam, that is to explain for those who know, you know what I'm saying, both what his spiritual role was and also how does that have to do with the race. Not for us to think like, wow, Christ is black, because I'm almost tired of hearing folks just talk about how black he is and how, see, God is black and all this, and they can't walk it out. You see, that is spirituality, walking it out. You know, like if he says when we go through tribulation to for his sake. See, if we go to tribulation because we did something wrong, what should we do? We should make amends. You know, because that's the discipline in the church right there. Matthew chapter 18. You know, we should make amends about it, basically, before we go and burn our next Aishans. Because if you read that carefully, he says if you have a gift, right, if you come to offer your gift and you remember aught that you have, anything you have against your brother or anything your brother or sister has against you, before you even bun that spliff, you should try to go make amends. But see, that would take a lot of discipline, wouldn't it? Because we all know we like to take a little puff right there and, you know, that make us feel a little irate, you know. But sometimes it also puffs us up. You know what I'm saying? That we really don't have that, you know, humility, you know what I'm saying, to really make that spirituality. You see, religion is the outer shell. We need religion. Religion is a discipline. It's an outer, basic outer. Religion is like saying, okay, we have to study the word. We have to read it. We have to become familiar with it. We have to get this word in our soul. So if somebody said a portion of scripture, we might not know exactly where it is in the Bible, but we will know whether it's Bible or not. You know what I'm saying? Because when we pray for the Holy Spirit, what do you think the Holy Spirit is attracted to? The Holy Spirit is attracted to the very same word that came to the holy men and some women of God in olden time. The very same word that came to the prophets. And you know, just about all the prophets were crucified or were killed. You know that, right?
Yeah.
Do we have five people on the line right now?
The word says that. Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying? So think about it for a moment. How precious what we have right now. You know, like, just write this verse down. I'll try to search it out where it says, as he is, so are we in the world. Wait. As Yeshua is, then there's another verse that really be getting to I. I wanted to get in I and to fill I up when he says, well, as he is, so are we in the world. And he says, the things that I do, you will do and greater. Well, hold up for a moment. You mean that what he has done, now this don't mean that, please, nobody go out and start walking on no water now. You know what I mean? Don't want nobody to go out there and say, I'm going to walk to Africa. You know what I mean? You know, I'm not saying that if the need required it, that one does not have that in Christ. You understand? But remember, it's like the test that happened in the wilderness. When you really study the test of Satan, of the devil in the wilderness, that when he said, if you cast yourself down, and that's why Christ responded, don't tempt the Lord thy God, because that promise that he won't let our foot dash against a stone is only when we're in obedience. It's not to say that, well, have not God said, you know, saying such and such and such, so go ahead, just throw yourself out there. You know what I'm saying? Cast yourself down. Remember what he said in that verse right there? He won't suffer your foot to dash against the stone. But notice how Christ, see what Christ was showing us right there was something very, very important. That's why I try to advise everyone as best as possible, get a Scofield Study Bible. You know what I'm saying? Because if you look at the Scofield Study, the footnote right there in the Scofield Study Bible, right? Because if we're reading the Old Testament, like the Jews or like the Old Testament, our ancestors read it, right? We're going to be in the same position that many of them were. You understand? I mean, look at Brother Paul. Paul was truly saved by grace, because Paul was one of them. And remember how when Paul was trying to preach the gospel to them, how they wanted to kill him? You understand? The same people he was down with, the same ones he rolled with. You know, it's almost like when I think about some of the Hebrew Israelites. I used to be down with them. You understand? I used to roll with them. You understand? I remember some situation which really remind me of what happened to Paul, except fortunately I wasn't let down in a basket out of a window down a wall, you understand, to escape for my life. But it was like, I was trying to say that everything we are saying right here about who Beit Israel is basically right and exact. But Ethiopian, his majesty, is like the capstone of that. And they wasn't having that. That's like what with Paul. You understand? They wasn't having it with Paul because they were still had the veil over their eyes. Right? If you turn to second, write this down, everyone, 2 Corinthians 3:14. So when we're studying the Torah portion, right, and this is why I love the Scofield Study Bible as well, that if you look at some of the footnotes, what it does is compare Old Testament to New Testament. So you're seeing what happened in the Old Testament, but then you see the upgrade. You see kind of like the link scriptures or the link verses of where Christ, he fulfilled that. Like when we talk about the Old Testament sacrifices, the animal sacrifices. Why do you think Rastafari is about like no debtors in that sense of no animal sacrifice and getting forward to the original? Because John never intended for that. What he did was give permissive will, like after Noah's time, in Noah chapter, what was it, chapter 9, I think, of Genesis, where he says about what animals to eat, what animals not to eat, and not to eat the blood, because the blood is the life. Now, see, that verse right there is very significant, because otherwise one doesn't understand what it means when it speaks of the blood of Jesus. Because some people talk about, when we talk about, oh, the blood of Yeshua, they're like, oh, that is dealing with some cannibalism, rah, 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 rah. Because remember, these are foolish and unlearned responses. You understand? Because they really understand a true spiritual response is that the blood is the life. So when we talk about the blood of Jesus, we're not talking about no, blood drive or whatnot like that. No, we are talking about the life. We're talking about a word that is a symbol. You remember how when Christ explained things to those on the outside, he explained them in parables or mythology? But yet, when he explained them to the disciples, why to the disciples? You understand? Because if you really seek to study the word, to know the word for yourself, to really study and to deny your own ego, because we all approach it from an ego. You understand? I have to testify that it probably took me some years. I've been talking about the Bible, talking about His Majesty, and it almost seems like only recently that I really recognized the real kind of removing that veil and really see that fullness of Father and Son as one in the Holy Spirit. And that's the same reason why Christ, when He said to the disciples, they're like, will you now restore the kingdom? You know, because we black people, or we people, we want to rule. We're tired of being out of power. You understand? But what he recognized that we had a spirit problem. We had a spiritual problem. And we had a psychological problem or a soul problem. You understand? Before we can then deal with the physical, carbon, organic, or the material world. You understand? You know, the material world. Plus what we people have been through. You understand, both collectively, you know, which is a part of that. You heard of the phrase generational curse?
Yes.
And what's interesting is that in this Torah portion, which consists of, constitutes Deuteronomy 26 and 1 to Deuteronomy 29 and 8, guess what we touch on? We touch on the curses for disobedience, right? And the blessings for, well, actually first is the blessings for obedience and the curses for disobedience. And we all should be very well familiar that we as so-called black people in general, you understand, in this hemisphere and what we've gone through is the outworking or the manifestation of Deuteronomy chapter 28 verses 15 to verse 68. But now what we don't perceive is that since we are under this, you understand, remember, we're already born. Remember the Bible says we're born in a world of sin? I had a brother when they asked me some years ago. I really would like to reason with him again because I didn't have a sufficient answer then. He was like, well, what's all this about? We're born in a world of sin. And I didn't do nothing wrong. I was just born, blah, 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 right? I mean, how old was that? But I didn't really even know the word well enough, like the Holy Spirit has instructed I, to really say, like, I mean, we're born in this effed up world. And we've been affected by these concepts already before we even come to consciousness. By the time we come to consciousness and even sight up the King, we have to recognize that the door to the Father's house is the Jesus Christos. Not just saying Jesus Christ, or not just having a black eye trait or iconography, which is positive if used in the right, the spiritual way. But that should actually assist us if we recognize that He is one of us in making this word flesh. You know what I'm saying? To make this word flesh, but how can that happen if our minds are blinded? Like it says in 2 Corinthians 3:14, but their minds were blinded. It says, for until this day remaineth the same veil. You remember in the tabernacle, there was a veil between the holiest and the holy of holies. In other words, the people would enter into the first square, you know, of the tabernacle. And the first thing that they would meet is the brazen altar. That's like in true Christina, in true Christ consciousness and teaching of His Majesty, the first thing we meet, right, is the foot of Christ. Why do you think it says the brazen feet? You understand? It's both a symbology of a higher spiritual metaphor, but it also betrays, or not really even betrays, but it also displays and reveals, you understand, His humanity as bronze, as brass, as burnt in a furnace of fire. But that's the foot of the cross. Well, what was at the foot of the cross? Well, the cross was a place called Golgotha. Golgotha, what does Golgotha mean? It means the place of a skull. Skull and bones, 3:22. 3:22, is that Genesis 3:22? Hint, 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 check it out. Skull, the place of the skull. Well, what took place at the brazen altar in the tabernacle? Now, you have to remember that the Levitical code was only established because the Israelites, less than 24, 48, I don't know how long it was, they had already violated the command, the 10 words. They said, we will hear and obey everything that Moses tells us. Just let us not hear God's voice because we think we're going to die. If we keep hearing that thundering voice of Jah, we think we're going to, you know, we keep hearing His majestic voice. You understand? We're going to die. But if we'll listen to Moses. And then before Moses was even up there for maybe a month or a little bit more, they had already sinned in the what? In the golden calf. In other words, they had gone back to the bondage of spiritual Egypt. In other words, it was Nibiru. It was the Hathor comet. It was the Passover comet. It was the destroyer that passed by. And in the Egyptian religion of that time, that was put in a parable sense of the golden calf. That's why when Aaron say, I'll make you gods that have delivered you out of Egypt, because they were still on that old expletive deleted. You know what I'm saying? That they were not even patient. You understand? So they had already committed a violation. So therefore, they've already shown that they were not worthy to live, that they needed a priesthood again. Remember what Jah's original purpose for Israel was? I think even around, what chapter was it? It was between maybe chapter 15 and before the commandment in chapter 20, where he had said he wanted Israel to be a nation of the priesthood. Isn't this the very same thing he says in Revelation chapter 1, that we are priests and kings?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's like he's still trying to get, not trying, rather, he is still seeking, rather. He is seeking for His will to be done. You understand? That's why Christ says that one who seek to do my Father's will. You know what I'm saying? This is my brother. This is my sister. This is my mother. You know what I'm saying? But in order to seek to do the Father's will, we have to learn of the Father's will. That's why he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. What are we heavy laden by? This world. You understand? This world. In other words, the way the world has us looking at things. That's why I point out what Christ says. He says, it says, as he is, so are we in the world. Because all power has been given to him. But if we are not in him and his word is not in us, you understand, then we cannot activate that power. That's why the kingdom of heaven is not some place up in the sky like people think, oh, when you die, you're going to heaven. No, no, no. When you die to yourself spiritually, you understand, and you enter into Christ and the family of Christ, you're entering into the kingdom of heaven. You see what I'm saying? In other words, the true church entering into, you know, the church, as it were, is entering into the kingdom of heaven. Here, I'll explain it to you. I'll give you an example. When Christ says to Peter that whatever you bind on earth, you bind in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth, you loose in heaven. Isn't that kind of amazing in a sense? In other words, we have, and why is that? That's because of Yeshua. You see, there are still demonic entities. Let's just deal with the matter. There are still demonic entities. You understand? And we live in a world where the God of this world is not the God and Father of our black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's not. The Bible clearly articulates that. It says that the God of this world, you understand? That means there's a God of this world. But yet, that God has already been defeated by Jesus Christos. That's why in the Great Commission he said that all power, which is like all authority, all authorization, right? All authorization has been given to me. That's why some people say, well, it's not in the name of Jesus Christos. Some would say, it's not in the name of Jesus Christ. It's in the name of Selassie. That's wrong. That's categorically wrong. The Bible testifies against it, and if you want to hear my word, well, check it out for yourself. If you keep on going, you're going to hear the Father, you understand, and you're going to hear all of us, you understand, on Mount Zion, because he says that it is in the name of Yeshua that we have authority over demons and devils. It's a real thing. You see, we are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So you see, we have to understand this, because this is his word right there. You know what I'm saying? And so I've been suspecting that why we have not, as Rastafari, really moved forward the way we should have is because, first of all, we're not listening and we have not really heard his majesty's teaching and we're not walking in it personally and collectively as we should. Therefore, we are not exercising authority. You understand? We're not exercising that spiritual authority. First of all, we're not allowing his authority to be in our spirit, soul, and body in that order. You see, a lot of people try to change what they're doing in the body first. You know, they try to say body and soul. That's demonic. It's demonic right there. They're trying to say if you get your body feeling good, then your soul will feel good. Yeah, it will feel good for a time, but that is a limited loop right there. That is not, first is our spirit. Because, see, the spirit is our God mind, our God communication. Because otherwise, we are vulnerable to the other spirits. You understand? To the other spirits that have authority, because Adam, the first black man, he sold his kingship. He sold his rulership. You know what I'm saying? He sold it not because of what Eve did, but because of what he didn't do. Remember, the woman was deceived. You know, Eve was deceived. So how did Adam do it? Adam did it willingly. And Adam, like I explained to another brother or sister just the other day, Adam wasn't, like, far away. Okay, we can say it's a metaphor. We can say it's a parable. That's good. You know, it still teaches. There's a mystery to that. You understand? What's the mystery? Adam was right there. Adam went along. Later on, Adam wanted to blame God and the woman. He said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me and I did eat. So he basically said, God, if you never gave me the woman, you understand, if you never gave me the woman, I wouldn't have violated your command. And see, this is a message for us as brothers, all the brethren listening. We do this, and we got to admit this, man. You know, remember, it's grace and truth. you know, grace and truth, that's together. It's not like, well, you can have all the grace you want, but you could be a little bit true. No, no, no. It's grace and truth. We have to have truth before God and man, in that order, before God and man. So when I looked at myself in that light, I'm like, that is very interesting. Because a lot of times we'll say, yeah, it's that woman that made me do it. You know what I mean? And it might seem a little bit funny on a certain level, but you know what? It holds down your spirituality. And we can talk about spirituality until the seven cows come home. You know what I mean? And that's all it is. We're not really operating where our words sound